Welcome back. I'm Rick Sanchez. Tonight, there does seem to be a fear among many that millions of Americans could be out on the street because while they used to be protected from eviction, that protection is not going to be there for them anymore. There are supposedly some 6 million families that have fallen behind on their rent due mostly to the global pandemic. The numbers are staggering. 15 million people in the U.S. owe their landlords as much as $20 billion in total. And while up to now they were protected by a federal eviction moratorium that prevents landlords from kicking them out if they didn't pay the rent, that is officially coming to an end. Who has decided to let the moratorium on evictions expire? Essentially, the President of the United States, Joe Biden. And while most agreed with him a few months ago that it should be lifted because, after all, COVID was on the wane, that is no longer the case. Because so many people have refused to vaccinate because of the transmissibility of the Delta virus, and because many of the unvaccinated are ending up dead or practically dying in hospitals, the wane is no longer true. And that is why President Biden is getting serious heat, not from Republicans, but rather from Democrats who say the president is betraying them and helping, quote, the wrong side. Here are some numbers to consider. In 250 counties, at least one-fifth of renters are behind on their payments, with the average renter owing at least $4,000. Nationwide, the bill for uncollected rent, $23 billion. But wait, wasn't the $50 billion in government rental assistance supposed to deal with that? Yes, it was. But the money has never been distributed. And what has been distributed has gone in a painfully slow fashion. In fact, only about 20% of the $50 billion actually has gone to tenants. Some of the worst-case examples? Listen to this. California allocated $1.5 billion. They ended up with about $1 million being approved. Texas, it was allocated $1.3 billion, but has only paid out $22 million. So if the money never got to the renters, but stayed in their homes anyway, then wasn't it really the landlords who paid the heaviest price? And oh yes, what did happen to the money?
Makes you wonder, doesn't it? The host of Creating Wealth podcast on iTunes also has a YouTube channel where he breaks down the market. Jason Hartman, good enough to join us now to talk about this. You know, as I was preparing that report that I just shared with you and our viewers, I did have a lot of questions come to mind. Why didn't the people get all the money? If they didn't get all the money, what's the situation in the housing scenario for the United States right now? Jason, are you as perplexed as I am?
Yeah, Rick, you know, those are great questions. And I looked at your piece and I was just appalled at the amount of money that has gotten to where it should be. You know, California, I mean, $1 million, that's it, out of, you know, $1.5 billion. This is insanity. It's just another government program where they're on the take and it's getting lost in bureaucracy and who knows where. But I'm sure it'll come out eventually, but it's just very discouraging.
I imagine then, was I right to presuppose that if the folks aren't getting the money that they were supposed to use to pay down their rent, then the guy who's really getting hurt here, or the gal, is the landlord, because they're not getting any money.
You know, you're right. It is the landlord, and that's definitely true. However, there's a whole other aspect to it, Rick, because as you look through that sort of supply chain of housing, if landlords are stuck with tenants that they can't force to uphold contracts and keep their agreements, right? Mm-hmm. Even though those tenants have been getting all sorts of government aid in terms of enhanced unemployment benefits and so forth, and for many, many months weren't spending any money. But, you know, household savings rates have actually skyrocketed, mm-hmm. oddly. It's sort of the opposite of what a lot of us thought might happen. And then there's a housing shortage. So you know, these landlords can't recycle their houses into the rental market or into the for sale market. Some of them might want to sell their properties. And so what you're really seeing is first-time buyers are also getting very hurt by these misguided government policies. And maybe now with the moratorium ending, we'll start to see some what's known as price discovery in the market, where the market will start to adjust and things will start to happen. Yes, evictions will occur. That is sad. But some people will pay their rent. So, you know, a lot of people that have been not paying rent can pay rent. It hasn't really actually been a problem of what they can or can't pay. It's just been a choice that they've kind of wanted to work the system, frankly, and not pay because they're taking advantage of the policies that are there. So some of them will pay. They won't all be evicted. They'll just pay up, and others will move, and maybe they'll move to a less expensive place. Maybe they'll move to a more expensive place in some cases.
So I tend to understand, and I think what you're saying is, it's really, yes, it could be a kind thing to do, and it should come from the landlord, but the government should not be mandating people to not pay their rent, because that could mess up the entire apple cart. That's what I hear you say.
You're absolutely right. Every time, Rick, when the government gets in the middle of the marketplace, they distort the market, they distort prices, and everybody suffers. Every time there's some sort of government program like this, you always see this type of thing, these distortions in the marketplace and a bunch of unintended consequences. That's what you have now. You know, look, I'm not completely against the idea of a moratorium and a forbearance. When it happened, for maybe 2 or 3 months during the darkest days of the pandemic.
Yep.
But to have it last this long is absolutely crazy when we've seen savings rates skyrocket, when we've seen people not willing to come to work, and we've seen employers having to offer insane compensation packages to what otherwise would normally be minimum wage workers, Dollar General offering basically $21 an hour and signing bonuses to work at McDonald's of $500, $1,000. I mean, they've just totally distorted the market and the economy, and they're going to create a massive amount of inflation in doing so.
Already have. Your point is a good one, and
already have.
I don't think that you lack compassion. I think you're just trying to make sure that the market plays by its own set of rules and not rules that are handed down to them. And I think that's a valid point. Jason Hartman, as usual, great guest. Thanks for joining us, man. That's great.